Okay, I know I'm probably going to like limit the room here, but I'm going to do it anyway. Okay, I want a show of hands. How many of you actually like in any form watching, playing, pretending in your mind you're good at it? Tennis, the sport of tennis. Where are you at? Tennis people. Okay, that's good. Like 10% of the audience, okay? Hockey. Anybody like hockey? Watch it, but yeah, wrong sport. I picked the wrong sport, didn't I? Okay. Well, it's a tennis illustration. When I was in my 20s, I worked at a place called Gold's Gym in Kelowna, and which most of you would have guessed, right? As a front desk person. But anyway, okay. Now, let's be honest. I was a front desk person, but they had indoor tennis courts there. And the cool thing was, if you went after hours, you had about 20 minutes before they shut the lights down. It's on a timer when no one was in the gym and you were allowed to, as staff, get out there and hit a tennis ball for 20 minutes. And I love tennis, so I went out there. And I remember one time I had this, they had these big bucket of balls. You could just take like 100 tennis balls and just practice your serve. And I'm just doing this. And all of a sudden, a tennis trainer walked by, one of our trainers. And he goes, oh, Joel, no. I'm like, what's up? He goes, yeah, you're doing it wrong, man. I said, oh, what's wrong? He goes, well, the first thing is you're facing wrong. You don't actually face the opposition like this. You kind of stand to your side. That's how you want to face. I'm like, oh, okay. And he goes, and then like also, he's like, the ball you're throwing in the air, you're not throwing it high enough. I'm like, oh. He goes, yeah, if you throw it higher, then you wait for it to come over, then you'll come over with more power. I'm like, oh, okay. So I do that, and then he goes, whoa, hold on. You're also throwing it wrong. And I'm like, what do you mean? He goes, well, you're throwing it kind of towards yourself, so when it gets in here, you're all kind of bottled up, and you're not going to get the power or the follow-through that you want. And I was like, oh, okay, I'll fix that too. And then finally, I turn to the guy, I said, is there anything I'm doing right? And he goes, not really. Anyone ever had that moment in sports with someone that knows what they're doing? Yeah. I actually have another friend from Edmonton, and we play like maybe every 5 years. And when he comes down, he used to be an ex-pro, and he's left-handed. And if you know anything about tennis, that makes your serve better. And so for the most part. And I start playing him, and I worked on my serve, and I actually would get my serve going really good. And then about three games in, he starts coaching me. Did anyone have a friend like that? Whatever sport it is, it's like you begin playing with it, and then pretty soon, no matter what, he's coaching you. Well, that's how it felt. Well, today I want us, if we will, listen to this. I can tell you, after several years of practicing and perfecting and practicing again and refining my serve, guess what, church? I'm still not very good at it. But listen, here's the deal. When it comes to your own serve, your own service, there's this thing in Christianity, a lot of you know it, you've maybe served for years in a certain area, a certain ministry. We even do this with our jobs and our careers. We just kind of take it for granted, right? I mean, how much more, maybe you're a greeter, you shook someone's hand on the way in, that's what you do, and we're thankful you do that if that's your role here. But maybe you've been a greeter for 20 years, and you're like, there's literally nothing I can learn about greeting. I have nailed it. I have the perfect smile, the handshake. I know when to go in, when to grab the door. You got to know when to hold it, know when to, never mind. Anyway, you get my point. There's some of us, we've done so much serving. Some of you say, well, I've been on a worship team for years, or I've led ministry teams for years, or I've worked with kids for years, that we can sort of rinse and repeat and get to this place where we don't think there's much we can learn. And I find it interesting that the only miracle in the New Testament that is repeated in every single gospel is the one of the feeding of the 5,000. It kind of brought this question for me this week, and the question is this: what makes this account so important that God chooses to tell us it four times? And I think the answer, and if you're a note taker, I think the answer is in the fact that we forget these vital principles of serving so often. We forget to remember, if you will, and if you're taking notes, this is the sermon title, Jesus Style Service. Jesus Style Service. That's the name of our message. And what we want to zone in on, church, is that every believer can grow in their service by following three principles. Number one, get out of the boat. Number two, focus on the right thing. And number three, bring it to Jesus. You say, every believer, what if I'm not a believer? We're glad you're here. Keep checking out God, church, and faith, and there's a part for you at the end. But listen, get out of the boat. Check out verse 13. When Jesus heard it, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. The question we get out of when Jesus heard it is, heard what? Well, if you remember from last week, or you can look in your Bibles and see, John the Baptist had just been beheaded. Herod, of course, set up this dastardly party, had his wife set up her daughter to ask for something, and she asked for the head of John the Baptist. He follows through. John the Baptist is murdered. The news hits Jesus. Now imagine that. And he's left in this place, church, of exhaustion and mourning, and he wants to get away, and he wants to get alone. So it tells us he departs from there. He gets in a boat and heads for some place away from the people. How many of you have ever had this feeling where you're just done with people? It's not wrong to admit it, okay? You're just peopled out. Ever gotten there? Okay? All right? Are you feeling that way now? No, don't answer that one. Don't answer that one. Just move away from the people on either side. But we've all had that, right? We've all had that moment where we're just kind of like peopled out. You want right now, if I could offer some of you like a free trip to the Maldives, you know, one of those huts on stilts. Does anyone know what can you picture that? Who would take that right now? Between a month, who would stay longer than a month? Be honest. Okay, 12 months, free of charge. Who's doing that? Okay, you're right. See what happens? It's in all of us. It's in all of us. We get peopled out. We get frustrated. We get fed up. We're like, if I could have that and, you know, 24/7 waiter service, drinks and food brought to me, right? We'd go for that. Well, listen, church, this happens so often in ministry, in service, but also in life. You know, and I know, the war, the wounds, the wear and tear. And you can often find yourself just looking for a boat out of Dodge. You know what I mean? Well, Jesus gets in a boat in his humanity. Yes, he is both God incarnate, but he is also human. And in his humanity, he just had the worst news given to him ever. Someone killed his friend. And now he takes off in a boat. Look what happens right after. He departed, verse 13, from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. Watch this. But when the multitudes heard it, they followed him on foot from the cities. Isn't it true that people classically don't respect you when you need time away? Isn't that true? When you need, like, you just need to get away, and it's not, you'll find people aren't like, oh, okay, I won't text you. They'll be like, whatever. Well, these guys are the same. They're like, oh, Jesus left in a boat? Let's follow him. And this is so classic, isn't it? And it's not just classic for Jesus to try and get away and get some alone time. It's classic for you. Who can identify with this? When you actually do decide, you're going to have a quiet time. Have you done that recently? I hope so. You're like, I'm going to have some time with Jesus, just me and Jesus, and you set up the chair perfectly, and you pull out your Bible, and you're like, here it is, just me and Jesus. And then your phone goes, and you're like, oh, somebody needs something. And the dog barks, and a kid crawls on top of you. Planes crash into your yard. I don't know what it is, but you understand who's had this recently. You're like, I'm trying to get alone with Jesus, and there's 10,000 interruptions. Well, that's exactly what's happening here. Most scholars agree there's about 10 to 15,000 people following Jesus at this time as he's trying to get away by boat. It's sort of a really funny picture. It's a race to the other side of Galilee Lake. You got Jesus by boat and all these people coming around the other side by foot, because they're like, well, if he gets out over there, we can meet him in that deserted place, and boom, then he can start helping us again. Look at verse 14. And this is an amazing verse to me. You kind of have to read it over a couple times to really catch what happens here. And when Jesus went out of the boat, he sees a great multitude, and he's moved with compassion for them and heals their sick. Check that out, church. He went out of the boat. The scriptures say he sees the multitude and he's moved with compassion for them, and then he heals a bunch of people. Jesus' style service, if you're taking notes, starts with getting out of the boat. What do you mean? Jesus needs rest. We can all relate to that. He needs to get away. We can all relate to that. But in life, we are often faced, friends, with balancing the tension between two things: solitude or service. How do I know when to pull back versus how do I know when to dive in? And what can happen if we're not careful is we pull back from the things we're called to simply because of opposition or fatigue. And it's the very time we actually need to press in and serve. Now, the disciples are going to tell us in a minute, Jesus, let's just get rid of these guys. Like, let's just push away from the people. That's what we should do, Jesus. We don't need them right now. You need alone time. We need alone time with you, which is funny already. So let's just push the people away. And what you'll find is that's the disciples' MO throughout the New Testament. It's really funny. They are constantly in the ministry of going, get lost. No, Jesus doesn't need this right now. Pushing people away from Jesus. Now, the difference is, what is it that motivates Jesus to get out of the boat? Note the word moved by compassion. If you're a note taker close by in your Bibles, jot down this or put it in your notepad on your iPhone. The word moved is the word bowels, okay? Now, it's not a gastric thing here. I'm just going to kind of leave that one alone. But the idea of the word moved here is to speak of being deeply moved. And one scholar puts it this way, to have one's inner being stirred. So Jesus is in the boat. He's exhausted. He's in need of rest. He's surrounded by disciples that are like, hey, we should just get rid of the people and, you know, let's have some R&R. But he sees the people and deep in his spirit, he's stirred. This word is stronger than sympathy. The word used is used 12 times in the Gospels. 8 of those are specifically given to Jesus. So it is his word. And in this, you could say his heart is greatly affected and moved, filled with compassion, with love for people. Can we just pause and say, did you know that that hasn't changed today? I don't know where you're at, who you are, but let me just state a fact here. Jesus is still crazy about you. Jesus is still moved in love for you. Jesus is still absolutely passionate in his inner being about your relationship with him. And in this scenario, he's stirred and his heart is affected with love for the masses. And so even though he's in need of rest, friends, what does he do? What does he always do? He gets out of the boat and serves. Where does it all start? In the heart. The heart of ministry is the ministry of the heart. And the heart of the matter is always the matter of the heart. It starts with our love for God upward, and it pours out into our love for others. You know, it's interesting. The founder of the Salvation Army was supposed to visit an area and speak to a bunch of people working for the Salvation Army and rouse them up to go out and love on the masses. But he got deathly ill. He got really sick. And so he could only send a telegram. And I don't know if it's because back in the day, it was expensive. You had to pay letter by letter. But he sent just a simple telegram to all of his workers. And the telegram simply read, others. Simply read, others. Just keep in mind it's about others. That sometimes when you're exhausted, mom, and you're like done being a mom, that often you just think, man, I don't have the resources. I want to just quit being a mom, quit being a dad, whatever it is. I can't parent right now. I don't have it. That first it comes from your relationship with the Lord who has an inexhaustible supply of his spirit for you. And second, it's poured out to others. And sometimes, believe it or not, the enemy of your soul is saying, man, I'm done with serving. I can't bother serving. This isn't working. Everything's coming against me. I should just give up. And God goes, actually pressing through that, pressing into me and serving in spite of that, and you'll find strength for what's in front of you. That's what Jesus models. Nobody else models it quite like Jesus. And the message is, what are we doing if we're not doing it for love of others? Every servant in every ministry should have at the heart of their motivation, loving Jesus and loving others. Oh, but this happened today and it attacked this. And oh, but that person annoyed me, or my schedule's not working, or I'm not feeling well. That is part of the war of pressing in and serving others. You say, oh, but Joel, I'm so stressed. I'm maxed out. Well, maybe you need a short break. But listen, the time when you need to dive back in is right here, when you see the people and your heart is stirred again. Jesus had a boat ride over. That's all he got for rest, and then he's out of the boat. His heart was stirred. He got out of the boat. Friends, can I just say this? We have to get out of the boat and love people sometimes. What do you mean? Everybody has a boat that they're in. I kind of was thinking about this. A boat is like the excuse why we can't serve. It's the thing we're stuck in, right? Why we can't attend a refresh group. Well, oh, this is happening. I'm too busy. But why we can't give. Why we can't worship on Sundays regularly. Why we can't pour into the lives of others. Go to a women's event or a men's event. It's a boat. We all have one. Even Jesus had one. And you know, it's that trump card that you use to kind of get out of jail. And the most common one, not just in this church, but in every church, and I've traveled a fair bit, the most common one I hear is, well, I'm just so busy. Did you know that sometimes your busyness is the very opponent to you actually getting fed the things you need to be normal again? Now, we get out of it, we get abnormal, we get attacked, and we pull away from others. Well, who wins? The enemy wins. The enemy wins. He's out to stop you pouring into Jesus and pouring into others. Well, I can't join your group. I'm sick. Well, I can't do this because I'm busy. And I'm not saying those things don't play a part. But let me tell you, each of you has a boat. And there's a need to get out of that boat from time to time. Maybe that's not applicable to you today. Praise God. But whatever the excuse, it can be, it can't literally be worse, I don't think, than Jesus here, who had his friend murdered. The one that he finished telling the crowds was the most godly person ever to live. If ever there was a reason for someone to stay in their boat and go, no, I am not going to serve, Jesus had the biggest reason, don't you think? It's like, are you kidding? My friend just got murdered. Wouldn't you just like hide in the bottom of the boat and let all the ministry and people pass? Jesus goes, okay, you know what? I see the people. I'm getting out. I'm not remaining in this. So that's the first thing about serving I see in here. Here's the second one. Number two, focusing on the right thing. Focusing on the right thing. Look at verse 15. When it was evening, the disciples came to him saying, this is a deserted place. The hour is already late. Send the multitudes away. There it is. That we may go into the villages and buy themselves, that they can go buy themselves food. There we go. There's our disciples. Look, just get rid of these people. It's late. And listen to all the reasons to send them away. We have no food. It's late. It's dark. Lord, we're in a desert. Like, really? There's no Costco here. So, I mean, we got to get rid of these people. There's three reasons, Jesus, why it won't work. Aren't we funny the way we give reasons to Jesus why something won't work? Have you ever done that? Who here's had a conversation with the Lord, if you're honest, and said, okay, here's the reasons why this won't work? Have you ever done that? I have. Lord, let me just educate you, Lord, on the logical thing here, because all this is going on, so this is why it won't work. I know you're God, but I've done the math. Have you ever done that? Sure you have. You've given the Lord all the reasons why something worked out. I was thinking about this. I remember 5 years back, we had a vision from God to start an outreach in our city called Gravity, and it was awesome. It was great. But we had all these reasons from people why it wouldn't work. I remember, well, students won't be able to drive to the plaza. Well, we shouldn't do it in a theater. We should do it in the church. It's not going to work in a theater. And then it was, there's no parking down there. Where are they going to park? They didn't care. They're students. They found places. They hitchhiked. They got there. Well, we didn't have enough money. Oh, it's too far from the church. And there's this thing that happens to us in ministry if we're not careful. Those of you that serve and those of you that walk by faith is where the logic comes in and the figured it out pushes out faith. You ought to always ask the question. You should always say, well, but what if the Lord? Maybe the Lord. You should always give room for Jesus to show up. It doesn't matter. There's nothing too big. You might go, well, I don't have enough paycheck left to pay for rent and the car bill, and now I got to buy this, and then the kids' winter clothes. But Jesus, you ought to pray and give room for the Lord to move and work it out. Sometimes, church, I think you'll agree, our focus gets off Jesus and onto the problem a little bit too much. For some reason, people will say, well, it's not the right time, the right place. I don't know, Joel, it's just not going to work. Jesus sees all these frustrated disciples, and they've tried to solve the problem. But you know what's cool? In John's gospel, we get a little glimpse into what he's thinking behind the scenes. This is what it says. He himself knew what he was intending to do. Isn't that a great verse? There's something in your problem, in your blockage, in your dead end that Jesus intends to do. I believe that because the Bible says, he who started a good work in you will be faithful to complete it in Christ Jesus. What does that mean? If you're at a dead end right now, you're at a blockage, you're at a, I don't know, my hands are in the air, it's not going to work out, I don't have, I've worked it all out, nothing's going on. That is sometimes the best place you can be. Do you know why? Because you get to the end of yourself and the beginning of God. Because it's in those times where you go, Lord, I don't know. This doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up. Of course it doesn't add up. Just like the disciples, the Lord's just kind of like knocking on the door of your heart and going, hey, that's because you have to ask me. Invite me into it. You're focusing on the wrong thing. Focus on me. He wants to teach you a lesson, church, in faith and surrender and getting your focus on the right thing. Verse 16, Jesus said to them, they don't need to go away. You give them something to eat. He does the same with us. He looks at you and he says, quit sending people away. Quit canceling on friends. Quit thinking we don't have enough to buy them this or attend that. Quit saying, well, that's not going to work because our resources don't add up. In faith, he says, you feed them. You give them something to eat. And I believe that with this, Jesus is challenging both the compassion of his disciples. How much do you love these people? But also the faith of the disciples. How much do you believe in me? Are you depending right now on your own resources alone to get you through this season? He doesn't ask them to do anything to meet the need without also guiding them through the work. Maybe you need to be reminded of that today. We're going to see that in a second. Whatever ministry you're in, whatever way you serve, whatever role you play in life, whatever requires your energy, your strength, your passion, when you're in relationship with God, you're not left alone. He's going to provide what he needs you to produce. He won't call you to what he won't guide you through. Now look at their answer, verse 17. And they said to him, we have here only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Now we know from the other accounts how the 5 loaves and the 2 fish came about, don't we? A little boy puts his hand up and goes, here, I've got my lunch. And it's this great, great account that we have. And so he gives his lunch to these guys, and these guys come forward, and probably one of the guys, I'm guessing Peter, was like, well, we do have a kid's lunch, and probably the others are like hitting him, like, come on, really? Why would you even say that? There's 15,000 people, right? The feeding of the 5,000, we know the 5,000 are men, but that means women and children. There might be upwards of 15, 20,000, we don't know exactly. The point is, why would you even mention Lord, we've checked our resources, and we have 5 loaves and 2 fish. Wouldn't you feel like a moron being the one that suggested that to Jesus? Really, wouldn't you be like, hey, here's what I got? And it's that way on purpose that they leave it in Scripture, but graciously, they don't put the guy's name in here. And I think this is us. This is us. It's like we should put our own name in here. It's like, Lord, let me explain this to you. Let me tell you why this won't work. I've done the math. What's the problem? We're focused on the wrong thing. We see the size of our problem instead of the size of our God. We go, well, this is the issue. Well, how big is your God? I've got all these reasons right now while this won't work out. Well, how big is your God? The disciples knew Jesus was powerful enough to meet their need, but somehow they'd forgotten it. They didn't turn to him for help, you could say. Instead, they take inventory of what's in front of them. That is so us, isn't it? That's so me. You know, you're sort of figuring out why something can't work instead of going, well, maybe with Jesus it could work. And what do? We compare our resources, our limited resources, up against his limitless ability. It's just, it feels like we've just got a small boy's lunch, right? We find ourselves saying, man, I don't have enough. I don't earn enough. I don't know enough. I don't, you know, and that's taking inventory on you, you, and you. Did you know that? But that's so backwards. We often start with our inventory, what we own, what we have, what we earn, and we get it backwards. You know, I think about the tithe and how people, Christians, give 10% of their earnings to the Lord. And when I first started tithing after I got saved, I was like, well, 10% is the Lord and 90% is mine. So I give the Lord 10%. Have you ever done that? What's the problem with that? The psalmist writes in Psalm 24, how much is the Lord's? Everything. Psalm 24 says, the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. And in my early days, I was like, okay, well, he gets 10 and we keep 90. And that's illogical. It doesn't work like that. The truth is, it's all his. He's loaned me some and I give him back what he asks, Malachi 4 says. And why is that so important? Why? Because if you don't have that approach that it's all his, then you'll look at what you don't have instead of what he does have. And when you approach decisions that are financial, you'll look at what you don't have instead of what he does have. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's and all that's in it. It says he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. I don't know if you're here today and you're like, I don't really need a cattle. That's fine. It's just a verse. It just means he's got it all. And we forget that often as we logically go through and try to line everything up. We forget he owns it all. It's just whether he releases a cattle to you or not. You see this in big financial decisions that require faith from people all the time. We have an Israel tour that goes every year and a half. And you know what happens is people approach that and you get two types of people. Some people will say, well, I've already been. That's great. But some people will come to you and they'll say, well, I would love to go, but where am I going to find that money? And it's their way of saying, I've already done the research and the money's not there. But then you have other types of people and they go, I don't have the money, but I feel in my heart I want to go. And so I'm asking Lord. And the stories you hear, you guys, it's not just that. It's any mission trip we've ever done. Went to Mexico once. Somebody said to me, I feel God's going to put me on the plane. And I just want to make sure I quote him right. I feel God's going to put me on the plane. And I was like, well, that's sort of insane. I'm not trying to rhyme here. But honestly, I remember going, well, do you have any? At the time, I was like, do you have any resources? Well, no, but God's going to provide. And then this guy's story of how God put him on the plane, because he didn't start with his finances and his figured out. He started with faith and asked God to provide. Now, sometimes people will go, I feel like I'm supposed to go on this. And they pray and God does nothing. That's not failure. But the key is, have you gone to the Lord first? Whether it's a faith trip, whether it's your finances right now, whether it's a relationship, maybe it's an impossible family situation, maybe there's a family member you're like at odds with, you're like, there's no chance, nothing's good's gonna happen. Maybe Christmas come around the corner and you're like, oh no, I have to see Uncle fill in the blank, and you just kind of worked it out already, it's gonna suck. But you haven't gone to the Lord yet and go, Lord, what if you did something cool this year? I had that recently with a family member. I kind of went, wow, this, nothing's going to happen. That's not a great situation. And then I went and pursued a person, and it was awesome. It was awesome. And I really felt the Lord challenge me. Could you just get back to faith, please, Joel, instead of telling me why something will or won't work out? And I was so convicted. I'm like, sorry, Lord. And I saw God move in a really cool way. Jot this down. Friends, we have to remove the possibility that God can't do the impossible. Did you hear me? I'll say it again. We need to remove the possibility that God can't do the impossible. Oh, it doesn't add up. It never adds up. That's why you need faith. Do you know that it is impossible? Hebrews 11:6 says it's impossible, friends, to please God without faith. So think about that. So if you're just dialing it in, you're like, oh, you know, I'm on the I don't know, chair setup team, but I just dial it in. I mean, you need to do things in faith. You need to ask God afresh, Lord, what? How could I be the best chair setup person? I don't know what your ministry is. I want to do this by faith. I don't want to just dial it in because I've got skills. I want my focus on Jesus. Get out of the boat. I'm in this boat. I'm stuck in something. It's like, get over it, get out, focus on Jesus, and get back in the ministry. Here's the third one. Bring it to Jesus. I love this. Look at verse 18. He said, bring them here to me. What? The lunch. I mean, imagine the one disciple that's like, well, we do have a lunch. Why did I say that? Right? Steward. Right? So this Tommy boy moment. It's like, why did I even blurt that out? I was so dumb. And the other guys are looking at him like, wow. You did it again, Peter, or whoever it was. What does Jesus do? He says, okay, let's start with what you do have. Because you're willing to bring it to me, give it to me and watch. Now, you know, if one of the disciples that had found food at this time, right? If they'd had their own food, they would have hid it, right? Like, okay, I'm not going to show him my falafel here. Not after Peter put himself out on a limb. Just going to hide the falafel in my gown or whatever they were. You're thinking this will never work, but it takes a kid, doesn't it? It takes a kid to pull out his lunch and go, I'll share. Aren't you astounded sometimes, those of you with kids, how awesome their faith can be sometimes? Like, oh, the stupid car doesn't work. Let's pray, Dad. I'm like, no, okay. And then you pray and it works and you're like, God, why didn't I think of that? I mean, how adult we get sometimes, but how awesome our kids are. I wonder who this kid is. I mean, just think about how his day started, right? He's running out the house. Sandals strapped on. He's like ready to roll. His mom stops him. Oh, hold up. Where are you going? Jesus, there's a bunch of the crowd. Everybody's going, Mom. Everybody is following Jesus. Someone said he took off on boat, but Johnny knows where he is. So we're all going up this side of Galilee. We're going to find him. And as soon as he gets out of the boat, boom. Well, have you brushed your teeth? You know, have you combed your hair? Did you pack peanut butter sandwich? Did you do that? No, Mom, who cares? Go make a sandwich. Mom, there isn't any peanut butter. Take the fish. Oh, fish. He's like, fish, what a great sandwich. Fish, the eyeballs, the whatever. This guy's fish and he's bread. He's running. There's all these disciples. They pull the audience. They're like, this is ridiculous. We can't feed these people. This is the worst idea ever. This will never work. Does anybody have any food? No, we're following you. We're hoping Jesus would do that thing like he did with the manna a couple chapters back. We're hoping that would happen. But one kid, I do. And you know this kid, right now, okay, for the rest of eternity in heaven, whenever this kid's name comes up to his mom in heaven, it'd be like, was your kid that? Yep, that's my kid. Think about it. This kid, man, full of faith. Who's that remind you of? It's a little bit like David. David's brothers are all like, this is ridiculous. Go home. What's David do? He's running with lunch for his brothers. It's sort of similar. Shows up. He's like, hey, what's going on? And all the brothers are doing the same thing. Oh, it was a mighty thing. We're never going to be able to accomplish this. Look at the size of Goliath. It's massive and we're all scared. Well, I'll do it. Put me in. That's faith. Faith says, oh, not how big is your problem, but how big is your God. Oh, but you don't understand. This thing is massive right now, Pastor. It's not as big as your God. It is not as big as Jesus. Now, you might have made it big, and the enemy might have poured a whole bunch of fuel on that. And it's massive. But guess what? It will never be as big as your God. And sometimes we are looking at our God and telling him the size of our problems instead of looking at our problems and telling them the size of our God. Amen? That's how we ought to be. Like, really? That's it? That's all you got, Satan? That's it? Look at the size of my God. These guys are like, it'll never work. And this kid goes, here you go. Have you ever had this? Have you ever written something off? I had this recently. I had to approach, who bought winter tires this year around? This year or last year? Winter tires, anybody? What are you all native Calgarians? You're like, we don't need them. Okay. All right. Well, I'm not native Calgarian, so I buy winter tires. And this year I was like, man, I don't know if I can afford them. Well, I don't always think this way, but I prayed. And then I went online and I was like having one of these, I was like, okay, Lord, I'm going to need your help. And I have one of these amazing things where I clicked here and I clicked here. Next thing I know, I got like half off. I'm like, this is awesome. And then I go to the store that I want to buy them at. And she goes, oh yeah, these particular tires, do you get a rebate with them? I'm like, of course. Of course you do. I prayed. You know, I didn't tell her that, but I thought that. And I go, book me in. And then she goes like this. No word of a lie. She goes, you don't want to book them in right now. I'm like, I thought we were friends. First the rebate and everything was going so smooth. She goes, you don't want to book them right now. I'm like, is there something wrong with the tires? She goes, no, you didn't hear it from me, but you want to book them on Monday. I'm like, I want to, but it kind of felt like that Star Wars, these are not the droids you're looking for moment, you know? I'm like, I want to book them on Monday. Yes, great idea, sir. We'll see you Monday. I was like, what? And then she goes, you didn't hear it from me, but Monday, all installs are one penny. And I reached across to hug her. No, I didn't. She looked like she'd hit me with a wrench. But listen, I was like, are you kidding me? Now, all of you in the room that need winter tires are going, can I talk to you after the service, Pastor? No, this deal's long gone. Listen, it was Jesus and me. Okay, but listen, do you get the point? I'll be honest. I can't even remember a time that I ever prayed for a deal on tires. I know. You're a pastor. I should have more faith than that. But for whatever reason, I was like, man, I don't think I have the resources to do this, so I'll pray. And then boom. One after another after. And it just kind of brought me back. And I walked home and I was like, I don't know how many times I've said this in my life and to my wife, but it's true. I find myself constantly going, why don't we just pray about everything? Have you done that? I'm like, why don't I just pray? I prayed and God did all this. Why don't I just pray more? And that's really the lesson, isn't it? How many times have I had the same adventure and not prayed? How many times have I done the same routine, whether it's getting tires or paying bills or getting stuff for the kids or trips or repairs, and I didn't pray and I came up against my absolute inability? Can you identify? This is the beginning of all victory in the Christian life. Write it down. Learning constantly to bring it to Jesus. That's the start of victory in the Christian life. Whatever it is taking your inadequacy, your lack of resources, your lack of funds, your lack of faith, and just going, here you go. I don't have much, but I'm here. Lord, what do you want to do? Your marriage, your kids, your schooling, your church, your situation, your anger, your jealousy, your body image, your identity, your friend, whatever it is, bring it to Jesus. And you're going to have a time to do that at the table of communion. Let's see how this goes. Verse 19, then he commanded the disciples to sit down on the grass. I think he was like, okay, you guys can sit down. He probably let the boys stand still there, right? But anyway, you guys sit over there. Here, you come here, buddy. Give me your lunch. Takes the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, it says. Looking up to heaven, he breaks it and blesses it. People are like, well, where's praying before meals in the Bible? Right here. Okay, so there you go. If you come in and joining us for dinner at First Friday, the potluck after church, First Sunday, the potluck tonight after church, we just lift your food before you eat it and break it and then bless it. And this is where we get it from. He gives the loaves to the disciples who are so confused right now because he's like, here you go. Here. Oh, yeah, how are they feeling at this point? Thanks. Nothing's going to come of this. And some of us were like that when we prayed and asked. And we're like, nothing's going to come of this. I just have a little prayer. A little thing, he gives the loaves to the disciples, they gave it to the multitudes. 15,000 to 20,000 people, verse 20, all ate and were filled. And the word filled means it's the word where we kind of get stuffed. Like it's like post-Thanksgiving dinner, amen? Post-Christmas, that's the word. I'm not making it up, go look it up. That's the word. It's not gluttony, but it's right before. You know, you do all those things, I'm sure you do. Thanksgiving, some of you don't, you're too young and you look too good, but I mean, you know how it is. You're like under the table, I'm just gonna undo one more belt loop. Come on, someone's done that, where are you at? All right, you're not gonna admit that, but we do all these things, but it's because we're just like, oh, that was good. Oh, I just want to need a nap now. This is the word. Stuffed, filled, and they take up 12 baskets full. These are hamper-sized baskets full of fragments. Those who had eaten were 5,000 men besides women and children. And what do we get out of this church? Once you have faith in God and what only God can do, listen, then God can do what only he can do. Once you put yourself in the place and you say, well, on my resources, nothing's going to happen. Good. That's right. You're correct. But with God's help, who knows what he can do? Now you've invited God into the situation. How quick are we? How fast are we to write off a situation or a person? That'll never work. That's going to bomb. How quick are we to go in the past? Not a common one. This is what happened in the past, going to happen again in the future. That's not what the Bible says. That God is working in you. He's sanctifying you. He's building you. He's changing you. He's developing you. He started a good thing. He'll keep going. He's going to keep developing you for his glory. Lift your head. Give what little you have to the one who is able. Don't be the bystander constantly going, this will never work. Sometimes our biggest issues aren't with what God can do in the future. They're maybe with what we don't think he did in the past. So they prevent us from praying. They prevent us from bringing it to Jesus. He can take your little and he can make it much. And look what happens. He breaks bread, it multiplies, and then what? There's 12 baskets left over, one for each disciple. What a great reminder. At the start, they're like, we got nothing. We got a small kid's lunch. Sorry for bringing that up. Then he divides that lunch. Here's a little piece of bread. And then they come back, each of them. What was that walk of shame like? The huge hamper of bread. Here you go, Lord. And they put them all down, and he's just like, here you go. Right? You kind of wish that it said, and then Jesus wrote their names, one on the outside of each hamper, kind of like he did with the woman wrote in the ground. You know, it just would have been cool, wouldn't it? This one's for you, Peter. Remember this. So why 12 baskets? So that they would remember what he is able to do. How he's able to take that which seems written off, that which seems done and dusted, that which seems a lost cause, and he breathes life onto it, he breaks it, and he multiplies it. Did you know that before God multiplies, he breaks you? Before God does a work in your life, did you know that you have to be broken? Before a mighty miracle and movement of God, do you know there's brokenness? There's a crushing, a lifting, and then a prayer. And then God goes, watch what I can do now. The only thing he can't do, brace for impact, did you just say that? The only thing he can't do is he can't pour out on that which won't get out. What do you mean? If you don't get out of your boat, if you're just kind of one of those Christians like, well, I'm not going to serve, I'm not going to, then he can do nothing. And you won't see the work of the Lord. I'll close with this illustration to prove a point. The great violinist, Niccolo Paganini, he asked for one thing after his death. He said his marvelous violin, he was pretty full of himself, has to go to Genoa, the city of his birth. And when it gets there, he said the condition of his will was that the instrument should never be played upon again. That's pretty arrogant, isn't it? He's like, my violin is so good. I touched it, I graced it. It should never be played again. Unfortunately, this condition he put in his will was the worst thing for this. Why? This peculiar type of wood is only good, can you guess, if it's used and it's handled. As soon as it's discarded, as soon as it's sort of put to rest, stuck in a wooden box, a boat, if you will, guess what happens? It decays. And so this exquisite, mellow-toned violin today has become this worm-eaten piece of worthless wood in a beautiful case, valueless except as a relic. And this molding instrument is a reminder to us that a life that is withdrawn from all service to others loses its meaning, its power, and its value. I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. And as they're doing that, I just want to challenge you, church. If you're not, get out of the boat. Pour into somebody's life. You don't, if you say, well, I'm not in a ministry in the church, okay, join in a ministry somewhere, or at least join in the ministry of sharing the greatest joy, the greatest reason for existing is Jesus Christ. He loves you, he's gifted you, and he's called you. Whatever the boat is, he knows. You can just bring your boat to Jesus. We're going to have communion in a second. Just focus on Jesus. Bring it to Jesus.